Yeah, welcome to our first expert talk here in Bad Säcking at the Vita Zahnfabrik. And we have here in the studio today one of, I think, the most known dentists in the whole world, especially for digital dentistry. Welcome, Bernd Reis.
Bernd, nice to meet you. Thank you for the invitation.
Yeah, it's a pleasure for us to have you here. And as we all know, we are celebrating this year 35 years Vita Blox material. And Bernd is one of the first users of the Vita material.
Yeah, actually, I just calculated it was 34 years now that we had our first Vita Blox.
Wow.
That we put in the patient's mouth. Yeah.
So let us talk first about your profession. Why are you a dentist? Why are you still a dentist? Because after 34 years, as I heard just now, why are you still working as a dentist?
Well, that's a very personal story. As a matter of fact, it was a question of about 10 minutes examine at the gymnasium that made that decision. I will either be a gardener working in the big factory of my parents or being a dentist. When I approved in math and French, I will be dentist, because then I will not have to wait for 6 years, what I would not have done. And yeah, I made it these 10 minutes. And that makes me a little bit feel shy and makes me a little bit thankful. Yeah, because my brothers that took the factory of my parents, they went bankrupt 7 years ago.
Oh.
So that really is, yeah, sometimes good luck.
So not only good luck,
no.
And you're also a good dentist, so I think that was the best choice you could make.
Definitely. Yeah.
But why dentist? On the gymnasium, you are learning French and math, and then dentistry, why?
Well, there were three reasons why I definitely wanted to be a dentist. First thing is, wanted to work with my hands, with my skill, handcraft, so that you can see a result, what you're doing. Second thing is, I wanted to work with people, with person, on a one-to-one base. And the third thing is, I did not want to sell myself, not to be a salesman. And that was completely wrong. I didn't want to do that because my parents always had to go with the clients eating in restaurants and things like that and blah, blah, and talk. And I thought, no, a patient comes to a dentist and says, hurts. And then, but that was completely wrong. I'm much more a salesman than I would ever have expected, even as a dentist. So two reasons, hand, yes, with persons, yes. But we're all salesmen.
Yes, salesmen. To become a salesman, that's very important for a dentist as well, of course. And what is the fascinating of being a dentist?
Working on that one-to-one base and sharing, sharing something that you can see, and not having the responsibility to be life-threatening for your patients. We only have few complications. I could not be a physician. I could not be a normal doctor. And that would be too many sleepless nights. So we're a limited field, hand, person, one-to-one. I couldn't imagine a better profession.
Okay. So it sounds to me that it is not only a job.
No, it's not a job.
It is like a hobby as well. As
yeah. You know, I had some discussions to come back to that with my partner. We were two when we started with Dr. Pohlmann and myself. And he retired, although he's younger than me, 2 years ago, because he wanted to have this job-life balance and things like that. Where I think I'm privileged enough not to feel that difference between job and lifetime and life, and so for me definitely it's a passion. Yeah,
it's a passion. Yes,
it's a passion to live in this on this wonderful planet.
Yeah, I can see and feel the passion of you. Okay. And that's brilliant. Actually, that's the best thing. It's the perfect choice to be a dentist, and you did the perfect way in dentistry as far as I feel.
I try sometimes, yeah.
So You mentioned this already, but 35 years ago, you were working the first time with VitaBlock and with the Xerox system. So you should be one of the first users of the Xerox system, isn't it?
I had the privilege that we had a prototype of the Xerox machine in our clinic. So we were the first private clinic to work with the Xerox system back in 1987, yeah.
So you hear, we have here the first guy, the first private practice user of the Xerox system. Bernd Reis, fantastic, really. So, and how did it come? At that time, everyone was working with the hands, and what is this digital thing? Why did you jump on this digital train?
For me, it was in the first time, not the digital train. I was always, you know, there are so-called beta testers, and I was always the worst case tester because I hate computers. I'm not a digital person, and whenever I could really handle a machine, it was so easy to handle that everybody could understand it. So if silly Bernd Reis will understand it, everybody, then it's tested it enough. So my approach was more from a clinical point of view. In my times, some of you might perhaps know Bernd Kleiber. He was my lecturer in Freiburg. And those days when I made exams, I'm really a dinosaur. The only thing that we could do in the posterior region were amalgam filling. So I had to do in my examination an amalgam filling. And then, of course, you have a gap if you want to have a tooth-colored, nice restoration without crowning a tooth. That was the gap where I got in clinically, yeah. And that's, I was trapped, yeah.
Cool. And at that time, the CAD CAM was not so experienced as today. How was it at that time? So just think back in the time and tell me, how was it to have such a thing? Actually, nobody knew at that time what it is. And so how was it?
Well, you made a very, very good point. Nobody knew what it really did. Also, the manufacturer did not know what it really did, because the man who wrote the software for the Xerox was no longer part of the deal when Werner Muehrmann sold the whole system to Siemens. Ah. So the first 1.5 years, about 20 Siemens engineers tried to understand what the machine is actually doing. Okay. And after 2 years, they found out, no, it's too complicated. We do not know how that works. And they wrote a completely new operating system. And on the other hand, that was extremely lucky for myself, for me as a person, because we, during that period of time, had treated patients and patients and patients, and we had 2 years experience before all the others started. So the university came up and said, well, let's work with that Xerox, and I have a publication, 5 cases, 3 months. I said, okay, fine. We have 500 cases, 2 years. And that made me a little bit in this education part, so that I had also the privilege to travel a little bit around and give courses and have contact not only with patients, but also with the wonderful colleagues.
Wow. So you named yourself Silly Bernd, the Silly Bernd. So, because you were so silly, but I think at that time everyone was silly or not used to such a device. You actually made the base of the Xerox system as known as today. So you were one of the guys, the pioneers in that workflow.
Yeah.
So your problems or your things which were arising directly went to this new software, to this Xerox software.
Yeah. Well, it was a Game Boy. You can imagine that.
Yeah,
we had a Game Boy as a processor, an Atari 68000. So with such a... The whole operating system was on a floppy disk.
Yeah, I had the C64, so yeah, I know what this is.
Yeah, and it worked out. And sometimes it was quite good that we were two in our clinic, because if we sometimes had some problems and if we sometimes created some gaps and things like that, we thought, oh, no. My partner said, oh, wow, I had today, that was not too bad. That will last for 5 years, you know. And by the way, if everything goes wrong, the French board is not too far away. So we moved to France.
that's a good point. Yeah, I'm from the Saarland, so
okay,
I'm
yeah,
also close to France. So that's so yeah. So which kind of material did you choose at that time? Because there was not, as it is today, so not many variations, not many materials.
That's not true. That's not true. That was the other point, really, that for the very first time, we had, due to the milling process, the choice where we said to the manufacturer, this is what we want.
Ah.
Because normally, if you look how we worked with materials before the CEREC area, they have to be either be cured or be fired. You had to think about shrinkage. You had to add additional steps that were necessary during the fabrication procedure. And for the CEREC system, we for the first time had a standardized, optimized, well-balanced material that had the same color, mixed opacity between dentin and enamel, the same strength as natural tooth structure, the same abrasion on the opposing tooth. So that really was the playing field for all the manufacturers like Vita, like others, who said, there we can really try to imitate best the natural tooth structure itself. And we, if we can have this standard once upon a time also for our individual customized things, then we are very, very good. So the material side from the ceramic was from the beginning in outstanding.
And which material did you choose?
Of course. actually, there were three materials in the market. It was the Vita Mark I when they started.
Yeah, Mark I. Yeah,
then it was back in 1991 that they changed it to the Vita Mark II.
Correct.
We had the Dyco material, which was a Corne material. And there also you can see perhaps the difference. Dyco had had a major problem with discolorations. And the Dyco inlays and onlays and crowns that were placed in the patient's mouth after certain period of time, 2, 3, 4 years, they lost the color on the top and they were completely translucent like glass. So that really was not the best known material those days when we started. But the Dyco blocks, they had this medium opacity, not losing the color, because once again, they had been milled out of a solid block. And we also had composite blocks, GC. That were the three things that we had. And I like GC very, very much, but one of the strange things that really happened is I have put one bar of these GC composite blocks in a drawer. And then about 10 or 12 years later, I opened the drawer by accident because that was one of these boxes, you know, where you put all the materials for experimental use and things like that. And when I took it off, they were completely brown. That was astonishing.
Oh,
so,
yeah.
So that made me be a favorite of porcelain from the beginning on. And it was just a wonderful material that we still use today.
So you named the Vita blocks, of course, you named the Vita blocks. And what role did Vita or the Vita blocks played in your CEREC beginning and in your further CEREC life?
Yeah, I mean, as we had good clinical results, good clinical experience, I had the privilege being in the German Institute for Postgraduate Dental Studies in Karlsruhe for 3 years. And there you learn a lot of things that were necessary in the beginning. So acid etching of a ceramic to have a good etching pattern on the ceramic side was one part of the game. The other thing is that we had a composite material for the cementation, not using a normal single phosphate cement or glass ionomer cement, but we placed all our restorations with heliomolar. That was good. A microfilled composite. And we were lucky enough that we, by accident, had from 1989 on dentin adhesives, where we did not know that these are dentin adhesives. But some years later, we found out that you use glutaraldehyde and malic acid, so it's glu-ma. And that was a dentin adhesive from 1989 on. And 1991, it was then the shift to Syntec. So yeah, it was a combination of many good things that made us,
And had everyone the chance to get such filling composites or cementation composites?
Yeah, of course. They were on the market for as a filling material. Heliomola was the first microfilled with microstructures composite material for posterior restorations.
And great success. You named also great success. You said great. You had great success with the porcelain in this yep. combination, and the fit was not that good as it is today.
No. the fit was exactly that situation that we sometimes thought, oh, that will not end nicely, and therefore we had in our re-examinations we had different criteria for the margins. We had perfect margin, we had a slight washout of the margins, we had deterioration of the composite material, half the width of the depth, then we had carriers and we had a deep carriers underneath. This were the criteria when we started, and we found out no carriers. We have, after 18 years, 1.8% of marginal carriers, what means that the gap as a protection against secondary carriers was not a big deal if you do the cementation properly.
That's a good point. I think doing the cementation properly is one of the key factors for the success sure. of in the beginning. And then the Vita blocks, you also said it already, they had the fine structure in 1991 with the Mark II material. So why did you jump, or why did you use then the Vita blocks Mark II material?
Oh, I could show you hundreds of slides of clinical cases where you just see that it is nice, it has a good adaptation to the tooth. I've been from the beginning, and still be am to, still today, I hate full crowns. So that combination of having the most tooth-like material, and that was produced ideally under these ideal conditions, and have the best placement technique, definitely changed my look onto teeth so that I could leave small edges, narrow areas where then I could bond with that tooth-like material like the Vita. And another thing happened is when that the patients said after the treatment, oh, that feels like a tooth. Mm-hmm. That feels like a natural tooth, other than gold or other than even full yeah. porcelain or porcelain fused metal crowns that we had there. Yeah, that was from the beginning on one of the things that we really loved very much.
So you said just now that you don't like crowns. So if there is a possibility to save the real tooth, you leave the tooth.
Yeah.
Oh, that's also good. I would.
I mean,
so you're
I mean,
still working.
No. But that really is my task. I think, and this I do really now for decades. That I say, be honest with natural tooth structure. It makes no sense at all that a doctor sacrifice natural tooth structure for prosthetic reasons and preventing that I am against carriers. I mean, if you have a prophylaxis and you see, look, there is a little bit on the margins here, you have to plot there a little bit, and then the dentist comes with a big burr and takes everything away, cupping that's not medicine, that's not ethic, that's destroying where we should fight for. We should really fight, and that has nothing to do only with a Vita ceramic, but to have this in one appointment that you mm-hmm. stabilize the thin walls without having fear of temporization, without recontamination of the surfaces. You bond really the ceramic to the most ceramic-like material, which is the natural tooth, and then you can really save a lot of tooth structure. And I think we all would have to learn that. Unfortunately, just hearing the latest numbers, the latest figures of Dentsply Sirona, and they showed that only 24% of the ceramic restorations, chairside restorations, are inlays, whereas 70% full crowns. That made me a little bit sad. Yeah.
So. Are you still using Vita blocks?
Yeah.
So I hear that you are still using
Vita blocks. Yeah, I think it's about 70 to 80% of the Vita blocks for the inlays, onlays, partial crowns, and that we still.
You still use.
Yeah.
Vita blocks. That's a good choice actually. Yeah. And if you still use it for 70% in your dental office, so you think it is still state of the art material.
Yeah. As long as it's relatively weak. If you talk about flexor strength, it's between 120 and 114 megapascal. But normally, if you are defect oriented, then you will have a pressure on your ceramic, and that is good, no problem at all. The problem is if you have tension, and this is with the full crowns. And as we avoid full crowns, we do not have these problems with the fractures. Of course, I see sometimes a fracture, but on margin ridge, we could discuss that for many hours. But to avoid these fractures has nothing to do with the strength of the material only.
So is it the combination why it is such a clinical success of the preparation of the area where you are using it and the bonding system?
Yes, and the possibility to do it chairside, to do it in one appointment without temporization. If you have a thin, normally you would have some caries undermining a cusp. As long as I do the prep and as long as my margins are in natural tooth structure, I'm fine. I then do the inlay and remove the caries only later on, so that all these areas are blocked out completely. So that's the maximum of tooth structure that you can preserve, so that you only remove the caries. And if you would do that with an indirect restoration, you're lost because you cannot do a temporary, you cannot send the patient away. That would cause problems. You even cannot do a normal impression, but a digital impression you can do. And if you do the restoration in the same appointment and just do the cementation 15 minutes later, or then you stabilize the whole rest and make a new entity of a natural tooth.
And if the guys out there would follow your rules, your named rules just now, they will have clinical success.
Oh, I hope so. Or they blame me. Or they blame me.
But you
But with
have.
actually, but we, but what we really do, and I'm a little proud of that, and I'm also very proud that Vita is one of the supporters of that study, is that we say we want the practitioner outside having a look on if he's doing the things good or not. This is called CSA, ceramic success analysis. So that means that when if every dentist can take part of that, and it's not about the CEREC, it's about full ceramic restorations, if it's a full crown, onlay, inlay, or whatever. And if you tell us what you're doing, and if you give us your placement protocol, and if you then tell us what happens with these restorations over a period of time, we will give you a feedback. What about your results in comparison with 150 other dentists that doing the same procedure, maybe other materials, and that on a longitudinal base. And this is, yeah, quite good, so that those that have higher failure rates, they can look what they can manage or that what they could do, either material selection or functional analysis or things like that. And of course, we can learn from those that have only low failure rates. What are they doing to make it a good success? And we just 4 weeks ago, had a release that this will be published again in Dental Materials for the second time now. 5 years ago, it was already. So yeah, it's a tool to help other dentists say, I can do it like the others or not.
So 150 dentists from all over the world, or
Yeah,
mainly
from
in Germany?
yeah, mainly in Germany, but it is available in English. It is available in French, in Italian and German.
So, did you hear this? I think.
CSA-online.net, or just
So,
say CSA, yeah.
CSA, look on the CSA homepage and then you can join the group, actually.
Yeah,
Yeah.
we are, the more dentists we have, the more reliable are the data, yeah.
So, another point is during the years, many different materials came on the market, but you still are using, as I heard, 70% Vitaflex material. So the others are also good materials,
I love them. I love them.
but why is it just the Vitaflex?
Well, if you that there would not be a major difference if you use Empress Cut or Vitablox. It's the structure is more or less the same. If you go into groups, if you would say lithium disilicate, whether if you take the Suprinity or the Emacs or whatever is there, that's a completely different structure because you then have to fire that. That means it's a workflow that works nicely and you can do the cementation adhesively. So I also like this material if I have thin walls, if I do not want to sacrifice tooth structure. Mm-hmm. I love these materials. But if it comes to the full crown, then you have a completely different story because you do not bond to the enamel. You do not mm-hmm. have an enamel edge mm-hmm. technique anymore, but you rely on your combination to the dentine. And this is a completely different world. And as we struggle for each little bit of enamel, Vita still is the one that is good and stable enough and to have a nice workflow and good results. Yeah.
And okay, the Vita blocks are existing in different forms, different mm-hmm. The
Mark shades and the Mark II, and then the Tricolor and
exactly
and the.
And so the Vitablox Mark II real is monochromatic, life, yeah. Trilux Forte are shaded in steps, and then the Real Life with the nose out of dentine. Yeah, and is which one is your favorite choice?
I never ever used the Real Life blocks. because I do not do any anterior restorations with the CEREC. This is the field of my wonderful lab technician. He loves doing veneers, he loves doing individualized things, and I do not want to do my learning curve on the anterior teeth of my patients. So for me, ceramic restorations is in the posterior region, molar and premolar, and that's fine. And therefore I like the Trilux plugs, especially if it goes up to, down to the buccal side. But on the posterior, on the molars, you do not need the dentine core and then the coat of the thing. But of course, those I admire these experts that can handle the material so properly that they show beautiful, beautiful results with in the anterior. But not myself; I'm too old.
So you're not doing the veneers; you're doing more inlays, onlays, and things like this.
Crowns and bridges.
That's also good. So, what would you tell your colleagues outside? Why do you to use still the CEREC system? Is it still state of the art, the CEREC system? Why to use the CEREC system?
I mean, it's one of the reasons definitely is to save tooth structure. That definitely for me as a clinician is that I do not want to miss the CEREC system as a single day. There is another point, and not pointing out too much the economic aspects. I say I'm not a salesman, you know. That's
yeah,
how we started.
I still remember.
You still remember, but of course you are a salesman. But if you think a little bit the other side, if you think from a patient's point of view, just think the situation. Breakfast. Mm-hmm. Oh, that hurts. Something cracked. Exactly. Okay, so I go to my dentist. What can you do? And then you know, the dentist will tell you, I will tell him, I can do an amalgam. I still do amalgam. I'm one of these dinosaurs. Yes, once per month. Or if a patient wants it, I'm still doing them. And you can either do an amalgam, that costs nothing, or I could do a composite restoration, which is about 100 euros or whatsoever. Or I do an indirect ceramic restoration. Okay. Now, normally, if you are a dentist, and then you have to think a little bit, if you want to have a full crown or a partial crown or something indirectly with the lab, you have to do a re-examination of all the teeth, new lines, mm-hmm. so because that has to be documented. And then you have to do a whole treatment plan for the patient. The Krankenkasse wants that also, so that you end up looking for the new lines, and then you will find another crown where mm-hmm. is some margins defects, and then you will do an X-ray and find another thing with the X-ray, and then you find some. Just go in the lab and just look in the lab how many models you have with only one tooth prep. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now think again on the other side from the patient's point of view. Coming home. And say, you know, I've been to my dentist, and there we can do either an amalgam. I hate the amalgam because of the mercury, or we can do a composite, but that's perhaps a little bit too big. And then, I felt so ashamed. He showed me with his camera, oh, that was so ugly, the other tooth, and the third tooth, and the fourth tooth. And to be honest, that causes some problems mm-hmm. in the family. One more week holidays or not. Or even worse, I cannot afford the health care that my dentist that I like wants to give to me for financial reasons. And that hurts. That hurts.
Absolutely.
Now, with the CEREC system, it is different because it makes no difference for me and for the patient if I do one restoration or five restorations. If I work indirectly with the lab, five restorations is much, much cheaper or much more effective for the dentist. And this is broken down because if you do one, two, three, four, five, you will have five times the return on your time. That means I also say, okay, you can do either indirect restoration or direct restorations, and then look to that one. That is also a caries. And look to this. I think from the X-ray that will come. But then it's up to the patient to say, well, we do that all now.
Or
I take 50 euros per month aside, and the next time I go to the dentist, doctor, can you do that or is it too big? Or the other thing is that we have in Germany a lot of insurances where you can make an insurance for ceramic inlays or crowns, and they will pay in the first year 500 euros, second year 1,000 euros, and so on. So that's another option where you're going with your patient. And by the way, I only very rarely see 12 cases of new caries just in 1 month in one mouth. Normally caries will occur there, maybe later there, but these cases where you have all of a sudden 12 caries cases where you have to redo your dentistry is okay. You know what I mean.
I know what you mean. Okay. Absolutely. By the way, I did choose also the CEREC workflow because one time only the injection and that's it. For me, this was the option actually to choose. But I'm dental technician, so actually I could do my work at home. But I did choose the CEREC system because of just one time injection. That was my reason to choose this. But you still work with a technician, you said.
Sure. I love technicians. And I also see that, I mean, if it comes to the anterior, I made maybe 130 CEREC veneers with 60 of them I'm happy or more or less happy, and the other 60 I think a lab technician could have done better. And in five cases I said to the patients, I redo that and you don't have to pay anything, but my lab, none of the patient wanted it because they saw always an improvement that it's not what I would expect for a dental work if it comes into the aesthetic zone. But of course there are some dentists, they have a technician education also, and they know how to do a cutback technique and all these things, and they make beautiful chairside restorations. A little bit the discussion in my eyes. Next week we'll have the CEREC master course that I'm organizing, and there we have Todd Ehrlich from the US might know, and we have Peter Neumann from and you also know Alessandro De Vives, and these three will have a battle on stage where we will start with Todd Ehrlich, who says, well, we're on cosmetic smile, in one appointment, and I will show you how to do that. And Alessandro will say, no, we have certain guidelines of aesthetic with rules, with laws, with symmetry and things like that. And he will show it with a mock-up. And then you will see Peter Neumann working in Neukölln, where a patient comes and says, I want to have 15 veneers. And then Peter will say, no, I think two are enough. And he makes them so beautiful that the patient is completely. So this is the world where we are today.
Very interesting. Yeah. And for the people outside, where can they find you? Where can they see where you are teaching? Where, if they want to come to a course from you, where?
Well, I now about 600 lectures in 40 different countries.
Yeah, I know.
During the last 30 years, but normally, most of my activities I do with the DDA, in Berlin with the Digital Dental Academy, which is an institution where you have a lot of chairside possibilities and of course a lot of lab technician possibilities to interfere that. It is the highest concentration of CEREC units where you have hands-on one-to-one training, and I love doing these courses because I can learn a lot from all the users, because they are the ones to have the interesting questions, and we try to improve and have that as a good feedback. Yeah, so it's about 12 to 15 courses per year that we do there.
Yeah, the DDA is a fantastic place for training. I've been there 7 times and it is beautiful.
Yeah,
everything there. It's close to the zoo, so if you are going there with your family, they can go to the zoo. It's also a fantastic zoo there.
Yeah,
thanks Bernd. Thanks to you, and I hope we see us again. I hope we see you again, and I wish you all a pleasant day, and goodbye.
Thank you for the invitation, and have a good day.